What is up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of the Hook Shots Podcast. I am your host, Joe Cermelli, and damn, am I excited about today's episode, because we've got a genuine, as far as I'm concerned, celebrity joining us today. That is right, the arguably most famous person to grace the Hook Shots Podcast thus far. We are talking today to my man, Captain Dave Marciano, who is my favorite captain on the popular television series, Wicked Tuna. So I got to start out by asking, you know, are you guys fans of the show Wicked Tuna? And I imagine that a lot of you guys are, no matter where you live in this country. I understand that, you know, it's a saltwater fishing related deal, but with all of these reality commercial fishing series that they've done, I mean, they're so popular, obviously, because they speak to such a broad audience. You don't have to live on the coast. You don't have to tuna fish. You don't have to saltwater fish to get into these shows. Now, truth be told, right, I'm actually not a big TV guy in general, generally speaking. Like, the last series that I watched where I would stop everything to watch the new episode on the night that it aired, swear to God, was The Sopranos. All right, and that's going back, I don't know, I might have been like in college or just graduated or something, but I watched every season of The Sopranos, never missed a single night when a new episode aired, and that consumed years of my life, okay? And since then, I never really want to get wrapped up in a series. I'm not a big TV guy. I don't want to be beholden to sitting down every Wednesday night to watch the new whatever. So even though I'm a huge fan of Wicked Tuna, I will admit that I have not seen every single episode that there ever was, nor do I make it a point to sit down and catch the new one as it airs. I am much more of a binge watcher of Wicked Tuna, you know, sometimes, which is rare in the HS compound here because of the children's. Sometimes if I have control of the remote and nobody else is watching, very rare occasion, that's often a go-to, man. You just pick one on demand, throw on some Wicked Tuna and you go. Every once in a while, they'll have a marathon of Wicked Tuna on. And, if it's winter or something and I'm sitting around doing nothing, I will watch the shit out of Wicked Tuna for hours and hours and hours. And I really, truly, do love the show. Of course, part of that is because I also tuna fish, you know, so it's personal to me. I've not caught a bluefin of the caliber that these dudes catch. So therefore, from an angling perspective, I love the show. So if you look at where shows like this started, right, it all started with Deadliest Catch. It's one of the longest running series, I believe. And that started so many years ago, and since Deadliest Catch has risen in popularity, they've tried to spin off so many other shows around the commercial fishing industry, and Wicked Tuna has definitely worked. A lot of them have not, you know, they have come and gone, but I've always been intrigued by all of them, because even though, you know, in a lot of scenarios, like let's call it like it is, you know, the commercial guys, they're the enemy of the recreational fishing fleet. And there's always a lot of, you know, back and forth and, you know, all this crap. But at the end of the day, right, I don't really care whose side you're on in a lot of different scenarios. You know, those guys are trying to put food on the table for their family. You know what I mean? Like they work very hard. And, you know, I have the utmost respect for anybody who tries to make a living commercially fishing these days, because as we'll find out from Dave himself, it's a far cry from sunshine and rainbows, okay? It's not an easy gig by any stretch of the imagination. And I'll tell you, you know, thinking back, I tried to watch the main lobster show that popped up for a while, which was directly trying to play off of Deadliest Catch. And again, I know some lobster guys, okay? It's a hard gig. It's hard work, man. It is backbreaking. But at the end of the day, lobster boats in Maine compared to the big boats in Alaska doing crab in the winter, It was like apples and oranges, man. Like, you just could not make lobster and look nearly as hardcore as the deadliest catch boys. So that one didn't last. And then you also had swordfish life on the line. Maybe some of you have seen some episodes of that. That was another one that was not around for very long, but I was really intrigued by that show, and particularly because a couple of the boats actually left. They were docked in the inlet that I ran my saltwater boat out of. And that was a fascinating show, too. My only gripe with it was, you know, that one was a little bit hard to watch as an angler because, you know, long lining is designed to catch a whole lot of fish in one shot. And the main target, of course, was swordfish. But you'd see these guys out there sometimes in some of the same places that my friends and I run offshore, and they're pulling in these long lines. And, you know, they would catch big eye tuna, which was not their target. And they'd be bringing one big eye into the boat after another. And they were like, ah, man, big eyes. Like, that's not what they want. They want swordfish. And then from a recreational perspective, I'm watching that going, damn, like, I'd kill to catch one of those big eyes in a single season, you know? So even though I was intrigued and fascinated by what the longline guys did, that was tough. That was tough. You know, that was the rec guy versus the commercial guy's eye that was watching that one. Now, conversely, you look at Wicked Tuna, those guys are just fishing. I mean, straight up, they're doing nothing any differently than a recreational guy that would want to go out and chunk for big tuna. And because of that, even though they're selling that catch, you know, it's different. It feels more like real fishing. They don't have an advantage. They're not out there taking more than anybody else is allowed to. There's an incredible amount of regulations placed on giant bluefin fishing, which we'll hear a lot about from Dave. So therefore, I don't know, you identify with that more as an angler if you tuna fish because, you know, it's not dragging nets. It's not setting long lines. These dudes have to catch one tuna at a time on a rod and reel, and the same shit that screws up the fish you have on the line for fun on a Saturday in the summer screws up their shit, you know what I mean? So it makes you look at Wicked Tuna, if you're a fisherman, from a different perspective. Now, the interesting thing about Wicked Tuna, I gotta tell you, you know, if you look at Deadliest Catch, the scenarios are so real, right? Like, it is that rough out there. It is that miserable out there. It is that dangerous out there that I've never really seen a lot of room for drama to be created artificially in Deadliest Catch. It's kind of like you don't have to because it's a dramatic situation all the time, you know, from start to finish. So you don't really see a lot of produced drama within Deadliest Catch. Well, the reality, let me tell you, of giant tuna fishing, the way that Dave and company do it, you know, you're seeing in that show a snippet of their season, all edited and jam-packed together really quickly. In truth, there is just an extremely stupid amount of downtime involved in the kind of tuna fishing that they do. These guys go weeks without a bite. And because of that, I think that the crew, they have no choice but to sort of manufacture a little bit more of a storyline, you know, manufacture a little bit more drama. Otherwise, what you're going to have is a bunch of guys sitting on boats doing nothing for a really long time, you know, between those bites. But that is the truth. That fishing is in no way, shape, or form fast or furious on the regular. And I'll tell you, I've been invited by National Geographic to go up to Gloucester, Mass. And fish with one of the Wicked Tuna guys. They do it sort of as a press media kind of junket deal. And that's about, 6-7 hours away from home. And the way it's set up is like, you know, come out on the boat for a day with one of the Wicked Tuna guys. And I've always passed because I know that driving all the way up there and giving yourself exactly one day to try and get one of those tuna on the line is kind of like playing the lottery. You know what I mean? I mean, that's the truth. And I've always passed. And I do, however, know, and this is no lie, four people who have taken that offer. Two of them actually went up to fish with the Wicked Tuna guys. It was part of a Nat Geo media gig. And then two other friends of mine went up there to fish the same area. They weren't on boats that were in the show, but they were boats doing exactly the same thing. Now, this is over the course of like 3 years, these four people went, okay? Zero, not one of them caught a tuna. Not one of them ever even had a tuna on the line during those trips. Now, there are other places, you know, Nova Scotia and things, where if you time it right, that action can be pretty fast and furious. But where these dudes are fishing in Massachusetts, and then a lot of these guys, Dave included, are part of the spinoff show Wicked Tuna Outer Banks. They go down to North Carolina in the winter. It is so far from a guarantee. It's so far from a guarantee, and the downtime is incredible. So I have kind of shied away. And the reason I like Dave so much, the reason he's my favorite captain on the show, is because he just kind of seems like the most no-bullshit guy out of all of them. And I'm right about that, and we'll learn why when we talk to him. But, you know, there's always this competition between boats and, you know, a fair amount of manufactured drama. And while Dave participates in that, because he has to, because he's part of the show, I don't know, just watching it from with an eye to having shot a lot of video and been on you know, television shoots with big production crews and things, you know, Dave always just kind of strikes me as the, like, what do you want me to say kind of guy. Like, it's in his delivery, you know what I mean? And I think it's he comes across as like the, what do you want me to say, when do I get my check kind of thing. And I always identify with that, and I appreciate that. You know, it's, and I'm not taking anything away from the other captains in the show. Mad respect for all of them, mad respect. But there are other captains that seem to embrace the publicity and the sort of celebrity that comes with it. And you know, they play that up. You know, TJ Ott, I bump into him. I don't know him at all, but he's at the big ICAST show in Orlando, the big recreational fishing industry show that I go to every July. You know, he's there with a different company, you know, come meet TJ, and that's cool. Hey, man, money's money. Like, I'm not knocking that at all. Like, hell yeah, like, jump on that. But Dave has always seemed like a little bit more toned down in that regard. And come to find out, spoiler alert, it's because Dave, prior to this show, is one of the few guys on the show that actually needs to commercially fish to feed his family, okay? Come to find out, some of the other guys in this show, if they never caught another tuna again, they ain't going to starve. And Dave is not one of them. So because Dave is kind of the no BS guy, you know, let's be honest. One of the fun things, you got to remember, Wicked Tuna, it is not a show made for anglers. Okay, any of these major TV network shows, right down to Mike Iaconelli's new show on Nat Geo Wild, River Monsters, hate to bring that one up, but River Monsters, anglers watch them, but that's not who they're made for. They're made to appeal to a broad audience, whether that audience fishes or not, which makes it fun then as an angler to watch shows like Wicked Tuna, you know, because I see the little things that the average non-fisher person is never going to catch. Like, you know, when they hook up a tuna, quote, on a live mackerel, and then they have the underwater shots during the fight, and there's a big old green stick lure hanging out of that fish's mouth, and I'm like, ah, ha-ha, ha-ha, gotcha, magic of editing. I saw that. So I thought it would be fun to talk to Dave, hoping that he would be sort of open about the truths, okay? The realities of this fishing, and sort of break it down into, you know, real world terms versus how it's edited and sort of manufactured for TV. And he did not disappoint. This was one of the most fun conversations that I've had for this podcast. I really enjoyed talking to Dave, And, you know, to preface, when I first called him, we had a little bit of a connection issue on the phone. So he had to change location so I could hear him better. So when we come in here with Dave, this is actually the beginning of call number two. And hey, quick note, I always ask my guest which song they'd like to be led in with. And while I kind of expected Dave to go like, I don't know, AC/DC or Motorhead or something, he went with Joe Cocker, man, a little help from my friends. And even though that is not as metal as I was expecting, I am a man of my word and will use that to play the man in. I'm tired, don't say it no more.
Hello.
Hey, Dave.
Yeah, how's it going? Any better?
Yeah, I can hear you better now. I don't know what was going on with that, but we had
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe just a shitty connection, or I was down on the boat.
So. I don't know. Do you have the radar spinning or something? Who knows?
No. It's just we are, like, it's low tide, so there's a building, there's a wharf, we're down underneath all that, kind of.
Yeah. Well, I can hear you perfect now. So, hey, I told you when I reached out that I'm a huge fan of the show. You're my favorite captain on it. And I got to tell you, man, I'm a little nervous. You're in a year of podcasting. Dude, you're the most famous person I've ever had on. You have people. I had people I had to go through to get to you.
Right. No, and it's not that bad. It's just it's for your benefit as well.
Oh, sure.
Because, you know, if they like what I'm doing, they'll promote it too. You know what I mean?
Sure.
They want the word to get out. Obviously.
Oh no, I totally get that. But interesting, yeah. Your people didn't ask me what questions I was going to ask you. So good for me. So I guess any shit goes here today.
yeah, for the most part. Look, like I have my marching orders too. You know what I mean?
Of course.
At this point, they you know, because like a lot of times, they'll have one. You know, Amanda will be on the phone with us. You know
right,
what I mean?
Right.
And that way, we don't if we hit these sticky areas. But she's done enough of those calls with me. She knows they're like, okay, Dave's good. We got
Yeah. Well, we both, you know. So, yeah. I'm with Field & Stream. You're with Nat Geo. We both know our limits.
Yep.
So we'll have a good time.
Yeah.
Anyway, you know, Amanda was telling me that you're gearing up to go to the Outer Banks soon, right?
Yes. Yep. That's what I'm down the boat prepping today.
Gotcha.
You know, we're scheduled to begin filming January 24th. I was hoping to have the boat there earlier, but we got in this fall after fishing, I upgraded the engines. I just dropped two new engines in the boat.
Ah, gotcha. Yeah, well, it's always something, man. I just sold my rig after 12 years last spring, and I miss it, and I don't. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But did you? So, Dave, I know that you've been in the commercial fishing game since you were in high school, right? I mean, you've been doing this a long time.
Well, like early on, you know, my career started, I guess, working on party charter boats.
Right.
So during those high school years and a little before, it was primarily, not always, but primarily, you know, charter and party boats. You know, you take from 6 to up to 50 or 60 clients
for
the bigger boats.
Sure.
Right. So that was, you know, most of my high school career. And then it wasn't until after high school, you know, then life happens and you get, you get married, you have kids.
Yep.
And, you know, then you needed to start making some more consistent year-round income.
Right.
And that's when, my early 20s is when I kind of branched off into predominantly commercial fishing.
Sure. So did you move your operation to the Outer Banks every winter before Wicked Tuna?
No. Look, I'll be honest. I would never go down there for the simple Well, I mean, I can make money here.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
You know what I mean? This is my backyard.
Right.
And if it weren't for the show, I wouldn't go down there. But the deal, you know, we signed a pretty good deal.
Sure.
And, you know, I'll be honest, after this many seasons, you know, when it all started, it wasn't a lot of money, but it was extra money. Right. So, I mean, well, I'm going to go fishing anyway, and they're going to look over my shoulders.
Right.
So at the end of the season, it was, you know, those first few seasons, it wasn't much, but it was like getting a check for three or four or five fish that we didn't catch. So
right,
it was,
right.
you know, 3 or 4 weeks free bonus pay.
Well,
right?
That's what I was kind of curious about, and I was going to get into that, but we can start now. I mean, one of the things that I love about you and watching you, because I've done some more heavily produced TV here and there, and on the boat is one thing, but I always get a kick out of like your sit down interviews where it's just the talking head stuff, because sometimes I watch you and maybe I'm wrong, but like at points it looks like, man, some producer just asked Dave to say some shit 10 times in a row and he just wants to like go have a smoke and a beer, you know?
Exactly. I guess that would be the closest thing we come to being scripted.
Sure.
Because what they do is they film for 6 weeks or 8 weeks, right?
Yep.
And then they take all that footage and they run back to L.A. And, we don't hear nothing for 4 or 6 weeks again.
Right.
And then they go and assemble episodes.
Right.
What happens in the chair is that's the first time, okay, now they've created an episode based on the footage.
Right.
And we kind of fill in the blanks.
Yeah, sure.
So there will be... There's a message to convey to the audience.
Right.
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 And it is written down. They said, okay, here's what happened, or here's what we want you to talk about, this issue here or that issue there. And, what they do encourage is us to do it in our own words.
Of course.
It's exactly like you said. So I'll say the same thing 10 different ways. So in editing, they can pick out the version that they deem the best.
Right, right. I have been there. I'm much better off the cuff.
Yeah. And,
that's why I was curious. I was going to ask you about getting paid for the show a little bit. Like, when they first approached you, did you genuinely have interest in being on a TV show, or was it more like, hey, here's some extra cash, which is...
I did it for the money.
Yeah.
I did it for the money. I did it for the first words out of my mouth. I mean, when this all started, they were in town for 10 days, right?
Yeah.
When I say they, the production company, Pilgrim Productions, all they do is produce reality shows.
Right, right.
The executive producer did some work on that movie, Perfect Storm. He was familiar with Gloucester as being very scenic, very beautiful.
Yep.
They heard about us catching these fish worth a lot of money, so the idea for the show was born. They were there for 10 days. I had no idea any of it was going on.
Right.
On the ninth day, they reached out to me. They gave me the rundown. They said, hey, Cap, we've been interviewing other boats and crews, and we got an idea for a show. And one thing we noticed was your name came up a lot. And they said, in our business, people talk about you. You may be somebody we want to interview.
Sure.
I said, the first words out of my mouth is there a check involved? They said, yeah, we'll give you $500 to come down and do a 45-minute video interview and tell us your story, right?
Right,
right. $500 is a good week's pay. They were offering that for me to come down for an hour and tell them my story.
Yeah.
I said, I'll be down first thing in the morning.
Right.
Not in a million years did I think it would lead to, me talking with you in Field and Stream. we just wrapped up season 8 this summer.
Yep.
And it's going to start airing March 10th.
Yep.
And, and just about to embark on going down to North Carolina to begin filming season 6 of our spinoff show.
Right. Right. So
I
imagine the money's gotten better, right? I mean, these things sort of start off as a test.
And I won't lie, at first it wasn't much, but the way I looked at it, I'm a commercial fisherman.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to go fishing anyway. They're going to look over our shoulder.
Hell yeah.
And at the end of the season, it was like getting a check for 3 or 4 or 5 fish those first few seasons.
Yep.
Now, I'll admit, it's gotten to the level now. After that first season, all of a sudden, before this started, we called managers out in L.A. and nobody ever called us back.
Yeah.
After that first season aired, then the phone started to ring. Because managers watch that shit, too, and they probably go, I ain't wasting my time with that, or this show looks like it might have potential.
Right, right.
So, after that first season, we finally get managers, and, the key was longevity. That first deal we signed was a 4-year deal, and obviously it was in their favor, not ours.
Sure.
But you had to, and at that level, it was like, when we signed, we knew it wasn't the best deal, but again, it was extra money.
Yep.
And hey, if we didn't do it, somebody else was going to jump up.
Yep.
And, I had faith that if it went anywhere, the long-term prospects could be good.
Sure.
And if nothing else, I figured a few years, even if the show fizzled after a year or two, it would give a bump to my charter business.
Absolutely. You know? Absolutely. Which people probably don't know that, I mean, you also are a charter service. I mean, anybody can hire you.
Yes, yeah. We charter both boats now.
Yep.
You know, we have myself with a new boat, Falcon, and we never got rid of the hard merchandise. My son Joe took over that boat.
Gotcha.
So they can charter with either boat. If people are interested in doing charters with us, we have a limited opportunity to charter in between filming season.
Sure, sure.
They can go on our website, fvhardmerchandise.com. FV is in fishing vessel.
I'll plug it at the end again, Dave. Don't worry. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, yeah.
So I mean, you know, one of the reasons I was so pumped to talk to you too is because I think the magic of Wicked Tuna, you know, here it is, this very salty regional thing, but it appeals to the whole country because I don't really care where you live. Watching people catch big ass bluefins is cool. It's cool shit, right?
You know what's amazing is it appeals to the entire world.
Yeah.
The show, right, is one of Nat Geo's number one shows. I believe it's 151 countries in 48 different languages.
Really?
I didn't know that. I have a public email, right?
Yeah.
And I get fan letters from, you know, Pakistan and India.
Really?
You know what I mean? Yeah.
That's cool. That's crazy. Well, you know, and I think the reason it works is because it does appeal to people who aren't sort of entwined in the saltwater fishing scene. But I watch it, as I'm sure a lot of anglers do, from, you know, with an angler's eye. So, you know, we were talking a little bit about the money behind this and, you know, the Outer Banks as an example. So the way I look at it when I watch it, you know, especially knowing that you wouldn't go to the Outer Banks for the winter of your own accord. Well, it's expensive to do that. So has it gotten to the point now where, hey, is Nat Geo, you know, paying to haul your boat down there and slip that boat, you know, or like, is that still on you, you know?
I mean, look, it's on me, but the contract I signed makes it worthwhile.
Sure. That makes sense.
You know, and again, I won't lie. Look, because of everything where we're at now, you know, 3 years ago, I started retirement planning for myself and my wife.
Sure.
That's a dream we never had. You look at my two kids on the show, who were with me, my son and my daughter, you know, they both graduated from college. They got their degrees, right? And they use that extra TV money to pay off their student loans.
That's
awesome.
They're
debt-free, basically.
Yeah.
Right?
Sure.
So, like, that's what it's meant for our family. So, like, I get it. We're not Brad Pitt, you know, and when I say retire, it's not going to be a mansion in L.A.
Right.
You know, for Dave the Fisherman, it's, you know, I got a retirement portfolio now.
No.
Those are words I never thought I would utter.
Hey.
You know, so it's buying us that security that we never planned on having. You know?
Sure. But, I mean, the reality is, though, it is still, you know, a spend a lot of money to make a lot of money business. And you know, when you guys hit the dock, and let's hypothetically say you put up a fish that the guy at the dock is saying is $6,000. We'll talk more about that.
Yeah.
But let's just hypothetically say it's $6,000. You know, to the non-angling public, they go, holy shit, that's $6,000 for one fish. That's amazing.
Yeah.
But I'm like, well, what was his fuel burn this week? What tackle broke?
Right.
What are your slip fees?
Exactly. Yeah.
So what
How many days did you go without a bite?
Exactly.
You know, because you figure, and that gets lost track of in filming. You know what I mean?
Right.
We have stretches. If you go, let's say we go 10 days before we get a fish, in between fish, which happens in real life.
Of course.
Right? You figure in, depending on how far offshore we're fishing, you know, it could be from $200 to $400 a day to be out there fishing.
Exactly.
So, you know, and again, they don't get into that on the show because it takes away from...
Sure. That's no fun.
And let's face it, when it comes down to it, it's the oldest formula in the book, right?
Yeah.
You've got the thrill of victory when we land one.
Yep.
And the agony of defeat when we lose one.
Yep.
And the rest is just a little bit of filler.
Right. So what's sort of the loose reality, though? I mean, to make a season in the Northeast profitable, I mean...
Yeah.
How well do you have to do to really turn a profit versus what's going back into the boat, going back into the operation?
Right. Well, listen, it's always, as a commercial fisherman, my thought process is different from a guy like Dave, right? Like, you got Dave in the .com, he's a pilot, tuna fishing is his passion and his hobby, and he's got that beautiful boat, you know, because he worked hard his whole life and you know, but he had a career somewhere else. Me as a commercial fisherman, the key to being successful is knowing when to not go tuna fishing, when to stop.
Right.
Because if you can't generate income every week, it's not that you shouldn't be wasting time tuna fishing. Right. I need a paycheck every week as a commercial fisherman.
Right. You don't have the backup sort of the,
Yeah. So, you know, for me, it would always be, look, if we can make a steady paycheck tuna fishing, we'll go tuna fishing. But if it's a slow year, right, if it's shaping up to be a slow season, well, I'll go put my traps out or my nets out or, you know, whatever it takes so I can make consistent income.
Right.
And so there's been years where, look, we caught three fish and it was real slow. So, like, you know what, we're done tuna fishing for the year. Let's put the nets out and go back to making money.
So
right?
When you say the nets out, Dave, what other things do you do? Like, you know, what do you
net? Gill nets. Gill nets is my primary fishery.
Really? Okay.
Fishing with sink gill nets, yeah.
Okay.
Now, that was kind of before the show.
Okay.
Again, I'll be honest now, like if you see the new boat in the show, the Falcon, that boat is more suited towards charters rather than commercial fishing.
Right.
You know, the old boat, the hard merchandise, that boat wasn't fast and furious and luxurious,
sure,
right? But it was versatile.
Right.
I could participate in 20 different fisheries in a year with that boat.
Sure.
With a big wide deck, and if we want to haul lobster traps, we can put traps on it. If I want to go gill netting, I can put gill nets on it. If I want to go long lining, I can go long line on it. And I've always done charters. You know, there was a time in my life where I didn't do any charters at all.
Right.
And I was strictly commercial fishing. But as, you know, regulations changed and times changed, you know, charters became part of the yearly formula to, you know, keep the ball rolling and keep money coming in.
Right.
So, you know, now, though, because of the show, I mean, let's face it, even after the show goes away, myself and my son will have a pretty good charter gig for the foreseeable future.
Oh, yeah.
As long as we treat people well.
Sure. It's amazing promo. You're right. It's like an investment
right.
in yourself no matter what happens with the show. For
yeah.
Sure.
Right.
So, I mean, I'm curious. So, you know, you said Dave on the .com, he's got another gig. In other words, he doesn't need
yeah.
that money. How many of
right.
the guys that we see on the show have that gig? How many have to versus how many just want to?
I think Paul and I are really the only ones who really have to. Everybody
right.
else seems to have something else going on.
Right.
And, you know, the thing is that's a pretty good makeup of the fishery as a whole.
Okay.
Right? We have a lot of guys here, too, with their 40-foot Vikings, you know, their
mm-hmm.
$15 million sport boats, and they come up and participate in the fishery, too, you know?
Right.
You know, people can have a debate of whether that's right or wrong, but the bottom line is, that's always been the makeup of the fishery.
Right. So you're saying you basically have the recreational guys that get the license and come up just to try and cash in during the season.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, to me, yeah, sure. On the weekends, some days I get frustrated because of that.
Yep.
But just like, you know, no different than anybody else when they get frustrated in traffic. You know what I mean?
Yep. Yep.
You don't hate the people on the road, but sometimes you get aggravated with them, right? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, absolutely.
It's not a life, right?
Yep.
Right? But, you know, that being said, it shows, you know, how well, with a lot of fisheries these days turning into individual access fisheries where, you know, they sell off the resources to the highest bidder.
And, right.
In some cases, like our ground fishery,
right.
they wind up in foreign hands, right?
Right. That's cod.
You know,
that's happening
to
in
me,
cod, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, to me, that's a tragedy.
Sure.
What's beautiful about the tuna fisheries, it's still an open access fishery.
Right. Right.
So anybody can participate. And
right.
I think that's a good thing.
And so that people understand, because it's not necessarily clear in the show, how many weeks do you have to do this in the Northeast
wow.
and in the Outer Banks?
Okay, yeah. Now, the show is a snapshot in the middle of our season.
Right.
The fishery opens officially June 1st and usually closes round about September.
Okay.
I'm sorry, around about November.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
depending on how fast. Now, that could fluctuate depending on how fast we catch the quota, how right. easy are the fish to catch.
Right, right.
Okay. We have a set quota for the season. And up here in the northern fishery, we operate on about 600 metric tons of tuna was our quota for last year, right?
Right.
Now, for instance, when we go down to the Outer Banks, like this year, we have 49 tons of quota to catch down there.
Right.
But there's much less boats that participate in that fishery.
Well, and isn't part of that because no matter what boat you're on, I mean, it's generally nasty down there. I mean, the fish are there,
yeah,
but it's hard
exactly.
fishing.
It's not the summer season.
Right.
You know, when the fishery happens up here, it happens during those, you know, June, July,
sure.
August. The weather's beautiful. Everybody, all those recreational guys who have their smaller boats,
right.
you know, they want to get out and use them. So tuna fishing, look, these fish are right in our backyard. They're
yeah.
not far. This time, sometimes we're catching them 3 to 5 miles out. So
right.
It's a fishery that a lot of people can access.
Yeah. Now, I've seen on the show, you know, every once in a while you guys will double up or you'll catch multiple fish in what appears to be one trip and you'll come in with two tuna. Can you come in with more? I don't think I've ever seen a boat
yeah,
come
well,
in with
every
three.
Year, see, there's always a moving target, right?
Right.
Because what we have is we have this fixed amount of tonnage for the year. Now, it's important that we, as fishermen, as a user group, catch the United States quota for the year. Because if we don't catch that quota, these giant tuna, you know, the quota we share with other countries. Each country has a set amount of quota they can land based on their historic participation.
Right.
The
right.
quota is divvied up at ICAT over in Madrid,
yep,
right?
Yep.
Now, if we are too restrictive and we come up under the quota every year, the other countries will petition to take back that quota from the U.S. They'll say, well, if you're not going to let the U.S. fishermen, let us catch it over here in Spain because we'll let our guys go catch it, right?
Right, right,
but
right.
at the same point, because it's a quota-managed fishery and it's all about sustainability, you don't want to go over the quotas every year.
Sure.
The curveball is it's fishing. We don't know exactly how easy the fish are going to be to catch on any given season.
Of course.
That's why, like, on some seasons, you have seen us be allowed as many as 5 fish per trip.
Right.
Or as little as 1 fish per trip.
Right.
And the problem is because, like, they're setting the rules for the fishery next summer up here right now.
Right.
So we have to make those decisions. And then people say, well, you know, why don't you change it? The problem is the way fisheries management works in this country. Like, let's say we start out the year, and again, if there's no fish around, having it 1 or 2 a day becomes inadequate because we'll have 100 tons of quota left at the end of the season.
Right, right.
And if there's a lot of fish around and they're easy to catch, you have seasons like we have the past few years where the fish are more abundant than they have been in decades,
right.
and they're easy to catch. So at 4 or 5 fish a day, we keep catching our quota 2 months before the fish leave. And like this year, the fishery closed in September instead of November.
Right, right,
right. Because
right.
they were easy to catch.
Sure.
But the problem is to make in-season adjustments, if we stop the season in June and go, whoa, there's a lot of fish, and you want to drop it from 4 to 2, under due process, okay, first you have to have a proposed rule that's published in the Federal Register, and then there's a 30-day comment period.
Right,
and
right.
then after the 30-day comment period on the proposed rule, they have to have a published rule.
Right.
And then there's another 30-day comment period. You know,
yeah, it's
so
complicated.
All of a sudden, to change the laws in the middle of the season takes 60 days.
Right.
In 60 days, you can catch 300 tons of quota.
Right. Sure.
If fishing is, you know what I mean? So it's one of the, I don't want to call it a failure, it's one of the frustrating parts of how we
sure.
manage.
And
overall, I fully support how we manage. But we do have these frustrating moments in our management scheme.
Sure.
But, you know, let's face it, U.S. fishermen are leaders in the world when it comes to successful fisheries management stories.
Right. Right, absolutely. And I mean, I feel like I see in the Outer Banks spinoff, Dave, like, isn't it often, or at least it's portrayed to be more down to the wire on quota, where it's like changing rapidly while you guys are out there?
Yes, and that's because, you know, again, we go from 600 tons up here to 49 tons
right.
is what we have down there to fish for, right?
Right, right.
So when you think about it, these are 500-pound fish. There's two or maybe three fish to the ton.
Right.
And that's not a lot of fish if you've got 200 boats out there chasing them.
Sure, sure. Now, I mean, naturally, too, I mean, the a lot of the tactics vary. I mean, would you say it's harder to catch these fish in the winter in the banks than it is up in Mass in the summer?
Well, yeah, to an extent, because, number one, you know, the situational aspect of fishing down there, it's a challenge. That inlet is no joke.
Yeah, I know, yeah.
You've got the winter fishing conditions to deal with. So it's a challenge. You have up here, at least, like in the summer, say in June, right?
Yeah.
Or July. You can fish 25 or 27 or even 30 days a month.
Yeah.
Because the weather's beautiful,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah.
Down there, during the month, you know, during a month of fishing in January, you'd be lucky to get out 3 days, 5 days, maybe 7 days.
Sure.
Right? So you don't have a lot of time to make mistakes. If you don't produce on the few days you get out,
yeah,
you can do really bad.
Yeah.
And you've seen seasons where we've struck out down there.
Right, right. Well, tactically speaking, though, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, the North Carolina crews tend to lean a lot more heavily on trolling. You don't really see that in summer
yeah.
up north.
Right, and that's because, again, situational.
Yeah.
Down there, we're chasing these fish in 5,000 to 7,000 feet of water.
Yeah.
Where we're picking up, you've got the Gulf Stream that comes up the edge of the continental shelf, and that's an 80-degree tide that runs to the north at about 5.5 knots, and the fish make up, and in that, you know, you have water pockets of varied temperatures that break off
sure.
when it mixes with the cold Atlantic water,
yep,
right?
Yep.
So you're chasing these pockets of water that yeah. the fish find ideal.
Yeah.
Right? And that can move 20 miles in a day.
Right.
That pocket of warm water.
Yeah.
So, you know what I mean? Down there, it's different. You've got to be mobile to fish.
Sure.
Here in New England, we're basically structure fishing.
Sure.
So even your freshwater guys know about structure fishing.
Right, right.
You find out where the fish are at or where they're going to be a lot of times. We, you know, fishing in New England is similar to, you know, some guys might compare it to, you know, deer hunting, where you set up and it might not be there deer any minute, you know, right when you sit down at your stand or your blind, but you will set up in an area where you're confident that deer are going to come by at some point.
Sure, sure, exactly.
And that's kind of how we persecute the fishery up to north, up
right.
the northern.
Right, and I mean, for people who aren't coastal, who don't know the offshore game, like what Dave's talking about in North Carolina, I mean, I imagine in the winter, you get a couple days of like really heavy cloud cover, you're relying a lot more heavily probably on your satellite shots and stuff down there.
Yep.
So if you don't
yep.
have them, that alone, not having the satellite imagery of where those spinoffs are, can screw
yep.
you right there.
Right, right, right. Absolutely, yeah. And like, you know, the first few seasons I went down there, I didn't have the satellite, you know, stuff. You
right,
know what I mean?
Right, right, right.
I would get it all secondhand from talking with other fishermen who did.
Right.
And then after fishing down there a season or two and having a tough go of it, it was like, well, this is an investment. And if I'm going to fish down there,
yeah.
you got to pay the $19.95 a month or whatever
yeah.
it is for the satellite service.
Yep.
So you can have the f***ing image. So at least you can have that information as part of your toolbox down there.
No, and that's true. I mean, it's like even here when I'm offshore in the summer, you live and die by that stuff and like pine
yep.
over those printouts. But
right.
Anyway,
right.
So I want to talk a little bit, Dave, about the actual prices of these fish. Now, I'm not going to lead you but I've heard some things about the prices given in the show, which I know it all corresponds to the supposed competition going on between you guys. But I have heard that the prices we hear in the show and the way it works is not exactly what it seems.
Yeah. Let me break it down for you.
Yeah.
You know, first of all, with these prices you see in the show, all right? And the reason you don't see us go back and forth is with the buyers, all right? It's these guys are working on consignment, right?
Yeah.
And we don't do buyers with with guys we don't trust. If you don't trust your buyer, you shouldn't be doing business with them.
Of course.
All right? The guy I've been selling my fish with, I've known for 20-plus years, right? So I trust him. Now, that being said, these fish are all going to be selling at an auction in Japan.
Yep.
And sometimes we don't know for 3 to 5 days what we actually got for those fish.
Right.
So these guys are shooting from the hip.
Gotcha.
When you hear them give us prices, they're giving us an estimate based on what they feel the market is and what this fish might do.
Right.
Now, that being said, because it wouldn't work for the TV aspect, it wouldn't work if we said, okay, Dave got $15 for the fish he got 3 episodes ago, right? You understand that?
Yeah.
For the TV aspect, we kind of got to spit out a number when we land that fish.
Right.
So,
right, of course.
You know what I mean? And that's what's going on. So the prices could be a few dollars either way of what we're actually
getting
quoted.
Sure. And I'm not criticizing that because, I mean, that's TV. That's what keeps the show entertaining people. I get it. But, I mean, I always kind of had that idea that the guy you're talking to at the dock, at the end of the day, he's not striking the check. It's like he's just giving you an estimate. He's just kind of gauging.
Yeah, he's giving us a ballpark figure.
Yeah.
And then you got the guys who go, well, what about isms, right? The what about isms, you know, and here's the thing, too. Now, I'm a commercial fisherman. My boat, the name of the boat, the old boat, right? Hard merchandise.
Yeah.
Now, we sell fish at an auction with that boat pretty much year-round, whether it's tuna or whether it's ground fishing up here in Gloucester. We have a Gloucester seafood display auction where the fish is sold every day, right?
Yep.
Part of the name in that is, look, when these buyers, so we'll come in the afternoon or evening and unload our fish, and the next morning at 4 a.m., the buyers all come down, and they start prodding and poking and looking at all the fish that were landed the night before, right?
Yeah.
Now, these buyers are looking for the hard, firm fish. Those are the fish that have been best taken care of.
Right.
So that's how I came up with that name, Hard Merchandise.
Ah.
We got the good stuff, right? We used to dominate the floor, you know, in our ground fish fishery on getting those higher prices because we might not have the volume of the big 70-foot boats, but we had the quality.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So it's the same type of thing, too. Now, when we're landing these tunas, like I lug around 2,500 to 3,000 pounds of ice the whole season.
Sure.
The rule of thumb is you want 3 pounds of ice for 1 pound of fish if you're going to properly cool that fish.
Okay.
Okay?
Okay.
So these guys running around in their center consoles with a 50-quart igloo cooler and sticking a f***ing 10-pound bag in the belly of the fish, right? And it's f***ing 80 degrees. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, you're great. You're fine. Go.
All
go.
Right. That's
preach.
Right. This isn't live, right?
No, we're not live. I can edit.
Okay. So, you know, these guys, when they stick 5 pounds of ice on a 500-pound fish, and they come back to the dock, and the body temperature of that fish has reached ambient temperature for outside, and you've got a 70-degree fish, all right?
Yeah.
They're not going to get paid much for that fish.
Yeah.
That's just, look at quality control starts the moment a fisherman catches a fish.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right? And
absolutely.
It's very important to the buyers. If you want a premium product, right? We're talking fish. Our product doesn't have a long shelf life to begin with.
Right.
Right? This isn't a can of peas we're talking. You know, the buyers can't buy this from Dave now and sell it in 6 months when the price of peas goes up, right? These guys got to be able to move the product. And again, we're talking a product with a shelf life of a matter of days. That's if it's been perfectly taken care of.
Right.
Right. So if these guys bring a hot fish from their center console that's been sitting in 70-degree weather for 10 hours,
yep.
right?
Yep.
That product has a different value.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Then if I've caught the fish and I've chilled that core temperature down all the way through to the core, right? That's what those guys are looking at when you see them prod the center of the fish. When they want to see the quality and the condition of that core, part of that is to see if it's cold inside there.
Interesting.
If that fish, right? If you bring a guy a hot fish, you just knocked off days off the shelf life. He's going to turn that fish around fast.
Right.
Because it won't last long. It's already hot. It's already hotter than when they took it out of the water.
That's interesting, right? About the core sample, Dave, because I always understood the tail cut, and I always assumed that the majority of the core sample was looking at color, but I never thought about that. He wants to feel how cold the center of the fish is.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, that's...
And they have a temperature probe that they jam in there, too.
Oh, really?
We have to record core temperatures for the government.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Okay.
That's all part of the, FDA crap stuff we have to do.
Right.
Because, you know, if you bring in too hot a fish, people can get sick of that with these tunas from that.
Right. Sure. So it's like FDA standards have to tie into that, too.
Yeah. You know, there's a lot in, that's why I cringe every time TJ's dogs lick the damn fish. they're going to bring a world of fucking hurt down on us someday. I mean, I got nothing against dogs, but let's face it, we're dealing with a food product here. If I had my dog on the boat, I would train it not to lick the fish.
I have a thing with dogs. I love dogs too, man, but like, I've never had an awesome dog on boat experience, especially offshore. Like, just leave the dog at home. So, you know, considering the value of these fish, I know that you guys will charter for giants if that's something somebody really wants to do.
Yeah.
Now, I think a lot of people out there in the world have this idea that, man, like that'd be like a dream for me to catch one of those fish.
So how does it work?
Right, because, I mean, do you allow, with that much money on the line, because that money's still yours.
Yeah, no, let me tell you how it works.
Do you
First
do stand-up? You know, what do you let them do?
No, we fish the same way you see us on the show.
Right.
Now, if people charter the boat during open season for tuna, and we do land a giant, only a federally permitted vessel can sell a giant to a federally permitted dealer.
Okay.
So only the boat can sell the fish. So unlike when we do our cod charters, you keep what you catch. When we do our cod and haddock trips,
right.
All the fish you catch, you get to bring home.
Right.
With the tuna, it's different. The boat's going to sell the fish. The clients receive, and this is pretty much the industry standard, although percentages will vary. On my boat, if they charter with me, right, the clients receive 25% up to the price of the trip. That's my policy, right?
Right.
Other guys may have, I believe Dave, because, you know, you're talking Apple, Dave's boat is a $2 million boat, right?
Right.
And he just got that boat. So I believe he gives 20% up to the price of the trip.
Okay.
So that's how that, and all the guys in the harbor will do the same type of thing.
So what you're saying is if I charter you for X amount of dollars, we go out, we land a giant, now you take it and you sell it, the most I'm going to get back is whatever I paid you to take me out.
Yes.
Gotcha. Okay.
25% up to the price of the trip. So you could get, a free trip out of the deal.
Right.
And, you know, 9 out of 10 times when that happens, people say, just f***ing book me this same date for next year. Right? Very rarely do I actually hand anybody a check.
Right.
If we get a fish and it doesn't do that well, most people are so excited about catching a fish like this.
Yeah.
I would say 50% of them just tell the guys to keep it for a tip.
Sure.
How many
people that reach out to you, though, I'm curious, get turned off by that? Because I've read on sites where it's like, hey, let's be clear. If you want to take some bluefin home to eat tonight, you got to let us take you out for 30, 40, 50 pounders.
Yeah, exactly.
How many people don't understand?
There is no recreational fishery. Well, we do that. Generally, the people who have a problem with that, you were never going to shout at the boat anyway.
Right, sure,
They bring that up to start, stir the shit on Facebook.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They like to start a dumpster fire.
Yeah.
Not that I'm not guilty of that in other areas myself, mind you. Who doesn't like to start a good dumpster fire?
Everybody.
And read the comments, before you go to bed so you get something to read when you're drinking the coffee in the morning.
True.
That's what Facebook was for, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. That's what it was invented for, to stir shit. And to that end, so here's one. Let's stir some shit, right? Because this is one I was curious about. I have a couple of crews that if they're going offshore, I go. And every time there's been an instance where it's like, hey, so-and-so's cousin is coming or this guy's coming, you're like, ah, shit. Like, he's just going to get in the way at the worst time. So what I'm curious about is when the show started, even through now, what was it like having a camera crew on your boat all of a sudden? And, like, were there instances where you just totally fucking lost a huge fish or something because dude stuck a GoPro stick in the wrong place or got in the way of a harpoon throw or something like that?
No. There's been challenging moments for sure. But I will be the first to say, Pilgrim Productions and the people that work for them, these camera operators, these guys are professionals, right?
Sure, sure.
And they walk that fine line, look, if we're going to lose a fish and they could help, the bottom line is it's not their job to help. They know how important those fish are to us.
Right.
The bottom line is it's their job to capture that loss.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
So that's hard for them sometimes,
Of course.
Because they would love to help, but, they would lose their job if they helped.
Right, right.
Now, so this is, and again, it's fishing. So we, even when I'm breaking in a new guy, right? I try to give him a rough idea of what could happen when we hook one of these fish. But there's no guarantee it's going to happen how I think.
Of course.
So you have to be ready, and we prepare them. I say, you got to be ready to adapt and change.
Sure, sure. And I certainly wasn't suggesting that, these camera guys are idiots or anything. I just mean,
even if
it was totally inadvertent, just like a wrong place, wrong time, should not have put the GoPro down just then.
Right, right.
Nothing like that ever happened.
I won't say it's never happened. I won't say it's happened to the extreme where it's cost us a fish.
Right.
I've had to rip shit out of the way, or I've had to yell, hey, get out of the way.
Yeah, yeah.
But, definitely not to the point where, oh, man, that f***ing cost us a fish. That's never happened.
Right. Well, that's cool.
But
that's good.
Again, there's been challenging moments.
Sure.
Without a doubt.
So, we talked a little bit about the amount of downtime, which is one of two things. So there's downtime between bites and there's the fight itself that are the two things that can never fully translate on TV. So, considering the amount of downtime, the days you guys can spend. Obviously.
Days and nights,
of course. Obviously, I have to imagine that there is some level of drama between the guys or storyline that has to be at least nudged along. And maybe it's something you can talk about, maybe not, but I'm just curious.
Well, are you talking to me on individual boats?
No,
between boat to boat.
Yeah, boat to boat,
All right, so look, the bullshit you see between boat to boat, right?
Yep.
Now, you're talking a long season, and these fish are worth money.
Right.
Right?
Right.
And let's face it, these fish are worth money, no matter how you slice it. So at some point in the season, you're frustrated, you want to catch a fish, or he's catching more than you, you want to get in on the action, right?
Yep.
So the elbows are going to go up.
Right.
Right? So what you see a lot of times looks like it's out of place. Like, that can't be real.
Yeah.
But, the bottom line is things do happen. You do get pissed.
Right.
And it's just now you know, like when somebody cuts you off, again, I'll use the traffic reference, right?
Right, right.
When somebody cuts you off on the way to work, you might f***ing flip that guy a bird and, you know, yell out a few choice curse words,
of course,
right?
Of course.
But the bottom line is then it's over.
Right.
But now, because, you know, we're filming, they're going to go, well, geez, why did you give Dave the finger?
Right.
So, you know, you got to kind of explain it.
Sure.
And then, right? But then what happens also is because it's a one-hour TV show, a lot of times there's little things that build up over the course of a season.
Right,
right. And then finally you reach a point with somebody
right.
where you f***ing let them have it, right?
But
because it's a one-hour TV show, they're not going to show all those little things that f***ing bothered you.
Right, of course, of course. And, well, I get that with the back and forth. But, you know, what I think I mean, Dave, is, you know, there's a lot of scenarios that are set up where the idea is like, okay, you guys are all together, like binoculars, if not eyes shot apart. And this guy's pissed because this guy's hooked up and they're not hooked up yet. When we're on his boat, it's pretty f***ing calm. And then when we go back to your boat, it's pretty f***ing rough. Like,
yeah.
I mean, obviously you guys in that scenario, maybe, I mean, is that just pieced together later, or at the time, were you all fishing together? I mean, how much of that is sort of fabricated?
See, here's the thing, right? Here's the thing they hate about me, right?
Okay.
Is I don't f***ing fish around other people if I can help it, right?
I know.
Even if fishing was good there, and then word gets out,
right.
Now even if we caught 5 fish there for the week,
right?
But all of a sudden, you know how it is fishing. You can't keep a secret,
right?
Somebody always knows, especially these days. There's a lot of eyes.
Yeah.
Right? So the first thing I'll do is, you know, again, on a rare occasion, that's exactly how fishing is. You got to kind of be over there to be in the game.
Right, sure.
But 9 out of 10 times, if there's a few fish over there where everybody is fishing, there's probably a few fish somewhere else.
Amen.
Right?
Absolutely.
Right? So I oftentimes will fish, you know, usually once or twice during the season, I will get a memo from production, and they're like, can you fish around the other guys today? Because we're making this TV show, and your other guys are on it, and we never have your boat near anybody else.
See, man, that's all I wanted to know. See, there
you
go.
Right. So they will say, look, can you fish around? Because, you know, and I get it. But, you know, the truth is we could be hundreds of miles apart.
Right.
But we will spend a day or two fishing together so they can get some of those shots where there's Dave over there, and there's f***ing TJ over there, and there's f***ing, you know what I mean?
Yep.
They do encourage us, you know, again, because we're fishermen and it's a big ocean.
Yeah.
Now, you know, again, there's times too, and let's face it, no matter what you see on the show, right, here's a little insider info.
Uh-oh.
With we're all talking together behind the scenes, you know, after work, after the cameras are down, right, and everybody's gone home for the day, we call each other up and talk because, look, the bottom line we know is it's in our own best interest for all of us to catch fish while we're filming this wicked tuna.
Absolutely,
right?
Sure.
If the show goes away, all the extra money goes away.
Right.
It's real simple, right?
Right.
So no matter what you see on the show, you know, after hours, we're talking on the phone. Hey, we got fish here. We didn't get fish here.
Sure.
We know where the fish is. Come out this way.
Right.
Now, we do that because we do that when nobody's around. Because we know if we did it while the cameras were rolling, all of a sudden we'd have to do the scene where, oh, so you call Dave and you're talking to Dave and now you're working with Dave.
Right.
Now you're working with TJ. Now you're working with Tyler.
Right.
Right? So we kind of have those conversations off the record, if you will.
Yeah. Yeah, of course.
You know what I mean? And up until this is, they probably didn't know about that.
Right.
Or, unless they're stupid, you know, and I don't think they are. I think they know. You know, again, because at one level, we're all competitors. But at one level, too, because of the TV show, Wicked Tuna, we're all on the same team. We want the show to do well.
Absolutely.
And if nobody's catching fish, we're not going to get a contract for a new season.
Right. Right. No, of course. I mean, so after all these years, Dave, I mean, you know, do you, has it become routine? Do you still look forward to filming a new season? Is it a job now? You know?
Oh, yeah. No, look, I look forward to it because right now, again, the past 3 years, right, have been the best 3 years of my life.
Okay.
Because of what we've built up.
Sure, sure.
All right. Now, you know, so that being said, it's been an opportunity for a lifetime for me and my kids.
Yeah.
And if this thing, you know, I just started retirement planning.
Yeah.
Now,
yeah.
We got a long way to go, but if I could ride this wave to go, geez, when Wicked Tune is all done, I can. Now, let's face it, you know, again, when I say retire, I mean, I'm a fisherman. I love fishing.
Yeah.
But, you know, the other part of it is, too, is I've already spent 3/4 of my life between, you know, commercial fishing. I spent 3/4 of my life offshore.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I when I was younger, before we had kids, I would do the 10-day trip.
Sure.
And, you know, the years go by quick when you're fishing like that.
Sure,
so
sure.
I've got nothing to prove. I'm okay with being in the financial position where I don't have to f***ing go anymore. All right? I'm okay with that. I got nothing to prove with nobody, all right? I've already seen it all. I've done it all. I've caught it all. I'm okay with, you know, and again, I still always have that passion for the sea. So, you know, if I could get to the point where I can coast and just do a few charters in the summertime.
Yeah.
And then maybe go on vacation in the winter like a lot of people do.
That's the life, man.
I'd be okay with
yeah.
that.
Yeah, absolutely. Well,
you know, and the reality is if the show keeps going, I may get there someday. And the truth is it won't be because of commercial fishing. It will be because of the opportunity that Wicked Tuna has given us.
Absolutely.
So, you know, Pilgrim Production and National Geographic.
Sure.
They've been great companies to work with.
Yeah. Yeah. No, absolutely, man. I get it. And, you know, I totally see where you're coming from. And I hope it sticks around a long time because I do.
Yeah.
I do love it. And I know, I mean, a lot of people, the success is huge. So I don't want to keep you too much longer, Dave, but just to wrap this up, I thought this would be fun. I looked up a few Wikipedia facts about you that I want to confirm whether they're fact
okay.
or myth. All right.
Okay.
So just to have a little fun here in closing, I read that the first tuna you ever caught was actually off of New Jersey.
No, that's David.com.
Okay. Then you got to talk to some people on Wikipedia. So there's
yeah.
one. Okay. You had some very notable accident where you got hooked at a young age that required you to go immediately to the hospital.
Yes.
Okay. What was that about?
Well, how young?
I don't know, man.
The first hook?
I don't know. This shit's pretty vague. To quote it, it said,
right.
Hook incident and you were immediately taken to the hospital to remove the metal. That's what it said.
Oh, right. Well, that's funny because there's a story my mom always tells friends and families about it. It's probably the first hook I got, which was in the arch of my foot when I was a little kid running around barefoot carrying my drop line.
Right.
You know, and Christ, I must have been 7 or 8 years old.
Yeah.
But there's been many.
So that was not some standout crazy incident then.
Right, right.
Okay. I read that you, for a time, you chartered in Key West or fished in Key West.
Yes, I did. Yes, as part of that career, kind of right after high school, the charter company that I worked for up here in Gloucester, Yankee Fleet, they would go down to Key West, Florida in the winter times.
Okay.
So I did that for about 5 years.
And that was party boat fishing or ground?
Yeah, party boat fishing for grouper and snapper. And then I did when, you know, they would come back to New England and I would go commercial fishing down there.
Right. Right. Okay. Did you like? I mean, did you get ate up with the Keys? I mean, some captains from the North go down there and they're like, "This is my shit." And some guys.
Oh yeah.
Hate,
well,
you
look.
Know.
Look. all right. Let me explain it to you like this. So we're just out of high school, and the drinking age in Massachusetts went up to 21.
Right.
And me and my buddies, my friend Dan, who happened to be, wound up a few years later being the best man at my wedding.
Okay.
He worked on the potty boats with me.
Yep.
We found out that the drinking age was still 18 in Florida. So.
Enough
so
said.
He said, yeah, yeah, let's go to Key West. So that may have been somewhat of a factor down there.
Could have been.
You know, I may have may not said in the past that, like, that 5 years that I fished down there was some of the funnest times of my life.
Right.
But
yeah.
There's also periods in that 5 years that may or may not be too clear in my recollection. So when I left Key West, I was like, okay, I got to get out of here.
Yep. Okay. So we'll move on from that hazy period to your current wife. I read that she holds some kind of fish record in Mass.
Yes, she holds the Governor's Cup, which is, you know, a state, a little state thing. They give her a little trophy for a 53-pound codfish she caught on the potty boats that I worked on.
Wow. So that, how long ago was that? I mean, 53-pounder, you don't hear much about them anymore.
And we didn't even have, you know, there's a lot of them out here. You know, it's, a lot of that's urban myth. But that's a whole other discussion.
Right. Next time.
With this cod fishery. But that was quite a while ago. That was before kids.
Right.
Yeah, because she was still coming on the boat. So that was better than 25 years ago.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So, okay.
We were still dating then.
Okay.
You know, it actually, like when I met her, working on the boats that I worked on. Her father used to come out fishing, and she came out with him on occasion, and
okay. That's
kind of how it's... Plus, she was friendly with my older sister as well, so it was a little boat.
Gotcha. Okay, so last one, Dave. I saw a picture of you online in a drift boat, trout fishing. Are you a trout or steelhead?
No, we tried that. Actually, I guess that was 3 years ago now.
Yeah.
It was something I always wanted to do.
Yeah.
And again, look, I'll be honest, because of the show, I think it was 3 years ago, like I finally had a little bit of extra money.
Right.
And we went up, and because I read about, you know, drift boat fishing and Field and Stream when I was a kid.
Right.
And I just never had the opportunity to do it.
Yeah.
And again, I think it was 3 years ago, maybe four. But you know what? It was like for my birthday, we went up and we went drift boat fishing for those steelheads up in upstate New York in the Salmon River.
Yep.
We didn't catch any, but it was cool to do.
Right. So that obviously that trip did not turn Dave Marciano into like a passionate steelheader.
No. Plus it was, it was neat to do, but it wasn't what I cracked up to be. It was
right.
Is part there... of me, you know, With all that, the finesse that goes into fly fishing, and I mean, I like all that stuff. I say this jokingly, but there was part of me was like, man, I could just stretch a gill net across this river, and we could go back and drink some beers and come back the next morning. We'd have all the damn fish we want.
Spoken like a commercial guy.
Standing in a boat, freezing, catching them one at a time.
Don't you know I'm all American? Was he not awesome? I enjoyed talking to Dave. I enjoyed that conversation so much. And I think one of the funniest things is you can kind of tell that when we start, you know, like you're figuring each other out. Like we don't know each other, you know. And he's got his marching orders, as he said, from Nat Geo. You know, he's got a kind of straddle of a line. And, you know, I know my limits. But, man, as soon as that first F-bomb gets dropped, it's like, pressure off, boom, let's go. Let's f***ing go. Which proves my point that while a lot of people like have disdain for people with extreme potty mouth, I am so much more comfortable around people that I don't know when they curse. Sorry, that's the truth. Like whenever I meet somebody new fishing or go on a trip somewhere, like is that not always the gauge with people? Like as soon as you drop a little F-bomb in there, it's like, oh, sweet, I can talk to this guy. I can talk to this dude because he uses the F word. And to be completely honest, Dave was exactly the guy that I thought he was, which makes me like him even more. Like, I will watch Wicked Tuna now differently than I did before having talked to him because I loved that behind-the-scenes look. And, you know, and a lot of the things he said I kind of figured as much just because I know the offshore fishing game a little bit. But, you know, it was really interesting. I had never really thought about that show as sort of being like a retirement plan for Dave. And what he said, you know, made a lot of sense. There's people I've heard over the years, you know, they like to give guys like Dave shit for, like, being on a TV show and, you know, blah, 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 and talk about how everything is made up and, like, he's not even one of the best guys. Whatever, man. I mean, Dave's real deal. He does this for a living. He always has. So when this show comes along and there's some extra money to put away for a rainy day, or as he puts it, when he just decides, I don't really want to go anymore, come on, that's smart. And I have incredible respect for that. And what was so interesting to me was when he was talking about how once the cameras stop rolling, all these captains on this show that are supposed to be enemies and fighting each other for that leaderboard with money that, guess what, is kind of not real because the guy at the dock doesn't actually set the price. Okay, when all that's done, when the camera goes off, yeah, of course these guys are on the phone. I don't know. I just think that's neat. Like, I would love to be a fly on the wall in those conversations between Tyler and TJ and Dave on the .com and Dave Marciano. And I would love to hear what they had to say about a particular day of filming after it happened. The conversations, I'm sure, have to be hysterical. And, you know, for some people, maybe the fact that they're all friends and are actually secretly kind of working together makes it lose some of its luster. But the truth is, right, I don't know if these guys were all friends prior to the show or not, but now they're all thrown into this fire together. Whether they were friendly or not before, they're all in this together. And the show is almost like no different than anybody's group of friends in the offshore game. Every single person that runs a boat offshore, especially in the Northeast here where you have to go far, like in Jersey, you know, we're going at least 40, if not 70 miles off to get to Tuna. So you always want to coordinate that. Everybody has friends on other boats and you try to make a network. You don't want to be out there alone. You want somebody on the radio. This guy's going to go over here. This guy's going to go over here. This guy's going to go over here. So it was kind of refreshing and neat to hear that they operate the same way because of Wicked Tuna. Okay? They all want each other to be catching fish. Now, for all the dreamers out there that would love to catch a bluefin tuna weighing 300 pounds or better before they die, hire Dave, man. I mean, you know, I joke that he's the biggest celebrity we've had on this podcast, which is true. But at the end of the day, anybody can go to his website and contact him. And funny story, that's what I did. I just found his email address on his charter site, which is fvhardmerchandise.com. And I emailed him and told him I wanted to do a podcast with him. And he got back to me, and I was pretty blunt. You know, I said, like, what I want is, like, the no bullshit look at Wicked Tuna. And he was like, I'm down with this, but I got to run it through my Nat Geo people. But point being that, you know, Dave's not unreachable. But you do also kind of know the realities now of what that fishing is about. You know, it's tough. And it's a crapshoot on any given year. And if you catch some 600-pound stunner, man, you ain't getting one piece of sashimi out of that fish. You know, so you do have to understand, you know, what you're in for. But the opportunity is there to fish with Dave Marciano, which, I don't know, that might be something I have to do. I feel like after talking to Dave, I would have a really good time on his boat. But maybe we'll go cod fishing or something with a little bit higher percentage, you know, because as dumb as it may sound, as ate up with tuna as I am, you know, while I'm really, you know, enthralled by those massive giants, you know, you watch the way that these guys fish, especially in the Northeast, you know, they're worth so much damn money that you can't play around. You know what I mean? It's like you are using high-end, super heavy gear. Those rods don't leave the rod holders, okay? Dave's not doing stand-up. He's not going to let you strap into a belt. And really, I would rather catch a 30, 40, 50, say 80-pound bluefin on a popper and a spinning rod than a 600-pound bluefin, you know, using a giant stick with a 130 caliber reel on it, you know, cranking for hours. So it's like a weird thing for me personally. Like I would like to say that I did that kind of, but I also know it would probably kill me. Like I would probably, like, my heart would just like explode right out of my chest, and with it, like, all the oil and vinegar from the Italian sandwiches that I'd just consumed prior to hooking that fish up and all that downtime. Take a lot of sandwiches, a lot of sandwiches for JC to go out on a giant tuna soak up in Mass. So I'm really into that run and gun thing, which, you know, for being honest, to guys like Dave and company, that's like weenie shit. That's like, good for you, Sonny, with your spinning rod and your poppers. So I don't know. Maybe someday I'll get there. I'm not quite sure. But I really appreciated, you know, hearing the ins and outs of it and the realities of it from Dave. So I hope that now when you guys watch Wicked Tuna, you have a better appreciation for the whole scene and what's going on behind the scenes. And now you kind of know who Dave is. Maybe we'll get one of the other guys on here eventually. I don't know. We shall see. But the new season of Wicked Tuna airs in March, and it's only right for me to throw a shout out of thanks to the people at the National Geographic Channel, because, you know, as we mentioned, Dave had to go through them. I worked with them to get this whole thing set up, and they could not have been nicer and more accommodating, and actually pumped that, you know, I wanted to do this and that Dave was excited about doing this. So huge thanks to those guys. Huge thanks to Dave for taking time out of his busy boat prep schedule, you know, getting the rig ready to go down to the Outer Banks when I talk to him. And hopefully he goes down there and crushes it. God bless him with those winter OBX conditions. Anyway, I will catch you guys right back here in 2 weeks. As always, thanks so much for listening to the Hook Shots Podcast.